Welcome to our webinar. I see people are still logging in for now. Thanks all for participating. I'm hoping we'll have a really interesting and enjoyable discussions. This webinar is part of a series that the Elephant and the Heinrich-Böll Foundation are partnering to look at the effect and the meaning of the May 13th judgment that declared the BBI process unconstitutional. It had many aspects to it. Today we'll be focusing on the historicity of it, what it means for Kenya's struggle for a new constitutional dispensation, how we can, what we as citizens can take away from it. So we'll be having a webinar pretty much every 2 weeks. And there's going to be 4 in total. So by the end of July, we should be done with it, but you're always welcome to participate in it. My name is Patrick Gadara, and I am the chief curator at the Elephant. All right, today we're joined by a really strong and really knowledgeable panel of constitutional lawyers, people who've worked on the constitution and helped reshape it for quite a long time. First off, we'll start with Sango Chesoni, who's a lawyer, a renowned human rights advocate. She's a former deputy chairperson of the committee of experts that finalized the current constitution, the 2010 constitution. Was a delegate at BOMAS during the entire constitution making process, and is also a former executive director of the Kenya Human Rights Commission. Zain Abubakar is a former executive director of the human rights organization Muhuri. He's a former commissioner with the CKRC, the Constitution of Kenya Review Commission, and also a former member of the East African Legislative Assembly. Waiku Wanyoike is a litigation director at the Open Society Justice Initiative. Before joining that, he co-founded and served as the executive director of Katiba Institute in Kenya. Wanyoike was admitted to practice law in Ontario, Canada, and in Kenya as well, and has litigated high-profile cases both in both jurisdictions before trial and appellate courts. And last but not least, Marilyn Muthoni Kamuru is a feminist, entrepreneur, lawyer, writer, and policy advisor. She's an ardent advocate for women and gender equality and equity. She has been the lead petitioner in the precedent-setting cases against the state on gender equality and women's inclusion, and also co-authored a seminal report analyzing women's influence post the 2010 constitution. And she is a founding member of the hashtag We Are 52% Feminist Collective. All right, thanks all. For joining us. We've got a lot to get through, so I think we'll just start off. First of all, what really for all of you, and this is, you can take it in turns, what stood out for you from this judgment? It's been described by people as landmark, it's been described as historic, you know. So what stood out? Maybe we start with you, Marilyn. What did you take out of it?
I think one of the things for me that was particularly ground-shaking was the language in this judgment, the very accessible language. The concepts are complicated, but there was a way in which this judgment was written for Kenyans, for us. And especially when I listened, actually, when they were delivering the judgment, and the accessibility of the language really struck me. At some point, my son was there, he's 11, and, you know, he would follow and then he'd ask me a question, but he'd follow parts of what they were saying. And so it really struck me that this was not a judgment that was meant for lawyers and constitutional scholars. And so even in the way the judgment was written, it was sending us a very important message. The other thing that struck me was the clarity of the reasoning. There were a lot of issues, a lot of petitions. It was, I mean, it really could have been a mess. And I remember having a conversation, I think, with Martha Karua when this case was filed, and I was like, oh my God, I just don't know what's going to happen. I mean, this case could just go helter-skelter. And so when I was reading it, I was really impressed by the clarity, the organization. It was very easy to follow. Even where you might disagree, it's very easy to follow the reasoning and the rationale. And why I say that's historic is because sometimes the historic nature tends to just be the decision, but the process is something that we're starting as Kenyans to really start saying, listen, process matters. The way we get to a place matters. And I really saw that in this. And then finally, I will say one of the things that really struck me is not just the focus on the history, but also the focus on inclusion and participatory processes. The detail that they went to, you know, noticing the number of women who were required to be present, persons with disabilities, the extent to which the processes were quite prescribed, actually. I think that's the word. And not glossing over that really helped reaffirm some of the work that we've been doing post-promulgation. So I think I'll stop there.
I think that was great. Zane, if I may come to you, you worked on the CKRC, you worked on the case CKRC and on this constitution, the one we have. Do you think the judges captured what you guys were aiming at?
Yes, they did. Let me start off from where Marilyn stopped. So in order to share with Kenyans, the choice of the language that is used in writing the 2010 constitution was also deliberate. Mm-hmm. It was also based on the demands of the people, but it also reflected the participatory nature of the constitution itself. So the judges were working within the philosophy already established by the constitution. Secondly, I think the judges got it right. For the first time in Kenya, we have a place where process and content are merged. Mm-hmm. So in order for you to understand the outcome of the constitution review process, you need to understand the process and the historical context. And the debate that informed part of the review process. Right. Largely, there were two schools of thought. There were those who believed that constitution making is a process of only experts and should not involve Kenyans. Right. And
the careful Wanjiko does not know what to do with a constitution.
Absolutely. Right. But underlining that proposition is an acute disrespect of the people, mm-hmm. so that the people don't matter. But in the end, in the fullness of the review process, the people themselves replied to this question by saying, in the architecture and philosophy and design of our constitution, the fundamental principle is the sovereignty of the people. Right. So again, Article 1 of our constitution. So people affirmed themselves and said, this is about us. This is going to be about us. But also this is informed by a historical context, Brother Gadara.
Right.
The Lancaster talks, the three rounds of the Lancaster conferences, was not very participatory.
Right.
Asango may want to speak to this better than I, because we only had one woman who was accredited as an observer. So right. All the official delegates did not have any women in this. And we met the lady in the constitution making process. So it is important for us to say that the judges got it right, in my opinion, by saying you cannot talk about just outcome. You must also talk about process.
Or the process itself.
And what informed that outcome.
Right.
I'll give you two examples. The first one Go ahead, Gazal.
No, I was actually going to jump out to Atsango, but yes, just sure. Give the two examples that you wanted to, and then I can move on.
The first one is how carefully the Constitution of Kenya Review Act was negotiated.
Right.
And how carefully it was constructed, including putting a provision that required the final outcome must faithfully reflect the views of Kenyans.
Right.
But the second one is, again, something that came from the court, which is when it was tested that the Bomas Conference, the National Constitutional Conference, does it reach a sufficient critical mass to be called a constituent assembly? And the court said no. So the court said you must finally, because this is not an elected delegates conference, although it is very participatory, right. But you must go back to the people through a referendum to either accept or reject the constitution. Right. Thank you.
All right. Yeah, thanks for that. Atsango, you are also very involved in the making of the constitution. And I'm wondering, I mean, there's a lot, I mean, even the both Marilyn and Zain have mentioned this about sort of involving the people and how this is supposed to be a people's constitution. You know, there was quite a lot of contestation at the beginning in the early 2000s, etc., about whether it should be a constitution made by parliament or made by the people. And we ended up with one that is said to be reflective of us. To you, this judgment, and then given that history of development, what does the judgment mean in allowing people to own this constitution, to feel ownership of it? Is that what was basically reinforced?
Yes, for me, it's an affirmation of the principle of participation and of inclusion, the principles of participation, of inclusion, of the fact that whether it be policy or even legislation, let alone the constitution, the people must be consulted. And the constitutional reform process in this country actually, affirms that principle. And so this judgment provides jurisprudence that affirms that principle. And it's a vindication of those of us's work to ensure participatory democracy, and the fact that we actually have a participatory democracy.
Right. Participation, what do you mean by that? Is it, I mean, because some people would argue it was going to go to a referendum, and that is participation.
Well, that's the beauty of the judgment. Right. It completely negates that myth. Mm-hmm. You know, participation is not at the last minute coming to people and saying, okay, do you agree with this? And yet, right from the beginning, they weren't part of it. And yet you have also appropriated their name.
Right.
You know, the judgment essentially says that you cannot you cannot claim that you're speaking for the people, and yet there is no evidence of them being the ones that were speaking.
Right.
And it's in things that are so basic as the fact that this country has two languages that are recognized by law, English and Kiswahili.
Right.
And we don't have a single draft of this supposed people's initiative in Swahili. This right. country also recognizes sign language, Kenyan sign language specifically, as a language. We have no evidence of attempts to ensure that people who are excluded by virtue of disability, be it people who face disability from the perspective of sight, mm-hmm. and therefore a braille publication of it, or discussions whereby the people were negotiating this constitution, these proposed amendments, and mm-hmm. availability of signed discussions, for example. So, yeah, even if you look at the principle of inclusion in terms of those who actually drafted BBI. Mm-hmm. There's a dishonesty about that. If you look at the BBA draft itself, it talks about quote unquote the promoters. It doesn't tell you who these promoters are. One of the principles under Article 10 is transparency. Mm-hmm. So, and this is not one of the things that was talked, you know, that is talked about in discussing the judgment, but the very, you know, but that's the level of the opacity.
Right.
Yeah, that, you know, we don't even know who these supposed promoters are.
Uh-huh.
And so for me, the principle of inclusion, when you look, assuming that the promoters are the BBI task force, when you look at the makeup of that task force and how it was put in place, and the fact that we were not even told that this task force was being put in place to amend the constitution.
Mm-hmm.
You know, as Abu has pointed out, as Zane has just pointed out, it was not enough that Bomas had a participatory process. When the court declared in those earlier decisions that you needed either a referendum or a constituent assembly, what it meant was that this country had moved to a level whereby we had said that if people are not elected specifically for the purpose of voting on a constitution, then
right.
we cannot say that this is, you know, this is the people.
Rather the mandate that we need.
Yeah, and I'm not going into the whole thing around like whether or not a popular initiative can be something that is, you know,
that government can
we'll have those discussions a little later.
Right. Wanyeke, for you, what stood out? You wrote for The Elephant a piece about how it doesn't stop us from amending the constitution, but it does put certain strictures. What is it that stood out for you, and what do you think we should take from as an ordinary citizen listening to a bunch of lawyers speaking? You know, what is it that I should really kind of focus on?
For me, a number of things that stood out. The first one is the centrality that the judges placed on history and used to anchor the decision. And this is extremely important because we know our governance, and especially since 2010 and even before, there has been a competition in terms of what the true history is. And there are people who are really keen on revising history. And this is why history was so important that it be reflected in a judgment like this that is so momentous. In fact, the most momentous judgment since the 2010 constitution came into being, and in fact, in Kenya judicial history. And I have to say, Zain Abubakar.
You think it's more momentous than the annulment of the elections? A lot of people would think that was a really huge.
Big. There's no comparison. There's no comparison because, first of all, this is about the life of the constitution and the integrity of the constitution. And when we talk about electoral justice, we're only talking about one aspect of the constitution.
Right.
But more
right.
importantly, an aspect that to some extent is actually very private. It's individuals fighting on who should be in power. And this right. is about the existence and the existence of a nation and the contract that people have with themselves about how they want to govern themselves and to be governed. So history for me and how just the judges went about rendering that history is unbelievable. The second is the where Muthoni started, just how judges managed to make such a technical subject so accessible. Some of us who pretend to be lawyers or to write like lawyers know sometimes how difficult it is to translate even basically very basic legal concept. Some of these issues are actually very, very technical, but yet the judges express themselves in such a way and the people were able actually to engage and feel as part of this litigation and to engage with the judgment. Two last points. One, the intellectual boldness of these judges. At two levels, this wasn't just an ordinary case. Remember, it's the one time the two feuding political side or the two political sides that pretend to feud came together. And they have been running on one course. Usually the judiciary, when it's making a decision, whether it's 2017 one, there's always a political side that is supportive of whatever outcome this would be. This was a case where the judiciary was largely alone. People also had given up. People thought that it was a referendum was a shoo-in. So largely the judges were just by themselves. And that level of boldness first, but also the depth of the intellect that they put in the judgment, for me, it's outstanding. And finally, obviously related to the intellectual boldness is the thoroughness. And colleagues have spoken to that.
Yeah, one of the things, Tango, if I may, one of the things that for me was interesting is comparing how they defend the constitution now, and how the judiciary in general, if you look at all the amendments that were passed to the independence constitution, the judiciary was missing as an actor that would stand up for the constitution. In fact, I think it was in 89 when they declared that they can't even enforce the Bill of Rights. What changed? What is it about the 2010 constitution that is different from the independence one, given that it seems they have many similar features, if you will, and it seems very much like 2010 was about reverting back to essentially to 1963?
Well, 2010 was not really totally about reverting back to 1963. I think there's a lot of lessons that had been learned. Mm-hmm. You know, and Abu will tell you because he's wonderful about this. You know, and CKRC did a lot of work on this. Between 1963 and 1969, most of the amendments that were problematic with respect to the old constitution were enacted. And so a lot of the work that went into the current constitution was around ensuring that you wouldn't have people that would be able to very quickly reverse and remove the provisions that that were being put in there. And this work actually precedes even CKRC. Mm-hmm. When, you know, as those of us who are members of the constitutional, those of us who participated in the constitutional reform movement, and Abu Bakr Zain and I both participated in that movement, people that were part of that process will tell you that when we would meet, the constitution was contraband. If you went to government printers in those days and asked to buy a copy of the constitution, they would ask you why.
Right.
We used to actually have to share. When we would have those meetings at Limuru, the Limuru Conference Center, we would be sharing copies of the constitution, and we would have photocopy the old constitution. So now, one of the issues with the old constitution was that even before the amendments, it already vested a lot of power in the executive. The president had the power to create or abolish any office not created by the constitution and not guaranteed by the constitution. Now, let me surprise you. Do you know that one of the offices that was not guaranteed by the constitution was the office of chief justice? Do you know that under the old constitution, you could appoint a chief justice that was not a lawyer? Do you know that this country had a chief justice that was not a lawyer? And so the judiciary, the judges did not have, were not guaranteed security of tenure. Mm-hmm. This is one of the ways the judiciary's independence was eroded. Mm-hmm. And although in 1963, they were guaranteed security of tenure, this is one of the things that eventually was taken away from them. It's the same type of issue in relation to the police, which we see BBI is trying to take away security of tenure for the police. And this is one of the ways in which they were again weakened under the old constitution. Now, one of the
judiciary was almost a department, I think, under the attorney general or something.
Yes. And, you know, we've seen attempts to reintroduce those kind of practices. Now, here's the thing. Pre-2010, under the old constitution, it wasn't even illegal to do those kind of things. Now, at least it's unconstitutional. And so these are some of the gains with the constitution that BBI actually itself, both through the way in which they were attempting to introduce it, but also through some of the legislation that there've been attempts to introduce. You know, there was a recent case where the attempt to again place the judiciary and the constitutional commissions under governmental departments was again struck out. Right. Yeah. And so the constitution protects judges today in a way in which it didn't, basically.
Yeah.
It also it also attempts to give them financial independence.
Right, but I mean, it's arguable whether they have actually utilized that in a consistent fashion. I mean, we've seen cases where we'd assumed that certain protections would be upheld and they weren't. You remember, in fact, even after the annulment of the elections, they somehow couldn't find a quorum I think it was a month later to decide whether the subsequent election was legal. So is it that they're not taking full advantage of what they have, or do we still have remnants of the old system that we need to get rid of?
It's more of one of the things that I've learned in the last 10 years is that it's not enough to actually change the legislative framework. Who you give the opportunity and the constitutional framework, who you give the opportunity to ensure respect for these principles matters. So today what we have is a situation where in law we have those guarantees, but sometimes we have people who hold office that either do not believe in those principles or are not willing to do what is necessary. And that's why Waikwa was talking about the boldness. One of the things about these judges is their courage, because I'm sure the judges knew that they would face the kind of attempts at innuendo, the opprobrium that they have faced. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right.
You know, post. So we have to, you know, for me, it's important that we acknowledge their courage.
Right. Yeah, but isn't Zain, if I ask you this, that they require courage, isn't that a bit of a problem? Because they should be protected. That would be the assumption that we've got a new dispensation that essentially gives them these protections and that they should be able to exercise their office without, we always say fear or favor, you know. What I wonder, I mean, I look at some of the ways our judges have carried themselves. I mean, we still have, for example, half, I think, of our prison population are people who have essentially been given bail at levels they can't afford, you know, and this is clear. Although there is a bail and bond policy that was passed under Justice Mutunga. So it seems to me like, At times, they seem to act in a very illiberal way and to comply, if you will. So there's not this constant challenge to the exercise of executive authority that I think this judgment represents. Do you think that would be something fair, that would be a fair assessment?
I think that's unfair. It's not fair. It's unfair for the following reason. reasons. First of all, transformation is a process.
Right.
Transformation is a process. You asked the question of comparing the independence judiciary and the current judiciary. The independence judiciary was a compromised colonial judiciary. And the constitution required that judiciary to be transformed.
Mm-hmm.
So again, in the architecture of the 2010 constitution, we knew we had to do something about a compromised judiciary. That's why there was a choice offered to judicial officers, either resign, go home, or go through a vetting process. So that the vetting process was one of the measures that was designed to give credibility to the holders of judicial offices so that One, it took out those who were not suited. Two, affirmed those who needed to. But also, there was recruitment of new judges. Why am I saying it's a process? Also give credit to the first Chief Justice of this country, Dr. Willy Mutunga. He started a transformative process in the judiciary, and it takes time. It takes time. But I would like to compare this with other organs of the state and other constitutional offices and also independent offices.
Right.
Compare the Judicial Service Commission and the other commissions. The other commissions, you have now a situation where majority of them, they've been compromised.
Yeah, they've been captured by the state.
By the state. And the people who are compliant have been the ones who have been put there. Yet we know that when we were looking at the architecture of governance, the three arms of government was not adequate. So we decided to design a fourth dimension, if you like. And that was constitutional commissions and independent offices. Remember how Ouko, the first auditor general, was hounded out of office. And all he was doing his work.
Right.
And then last 2 points. One, it is for that reason, that's why Article 3 of our Constitution is there, that the responsibility to defend the Constitution is a responsibility of everyone. And you see, in the language of the 2010 Constitution, we actually draw a distinction sometimes between citizens and non-citizens. But this is one of the places where we say all persons, it doesn't matter if you are foreign or, but you are in Kenya. It also doesn't matter if you are a registered company or you are a natural human being. All of us have a duty, responsibility to defend this constitution.
Right.
And then lastly, in terms of saying what has happened in terms of contextualizing what is going on in our country, the judiciary has become like the last line of defense. And sometimes I worry that because we as citizens are not carrying the burden of implementing this constitution and defending this constitution, we are putting undue pressure on the final arbiter, who is the judiciary. That's why when my brother Waikwa talks about boldness, we know that people use structures, sometimes some of them legal, some of them not legal, in the state to put pressure on state officers.
Right.
And then let me finish by saying, this thing went through parliament. Parliament is an arm of government. and you have absolutely eminent legal scholars in that parliament, people who are very highly qualified. And they were talking on both sides of their mouth. One saying, no, it is unconstitutional, but yes, I support it. It's crazy. Absolutely crazy.
Marilyn, if I may bring you in on this, you have given a petition, the Chief Justice, to get Parliament dissolved because of its unconstitutionality. And it was for a long time that the immediate former CJ pretty much sat on that that petition, only issued it when he was on his way out the door, you know. And those some of the reasons that we might think that it is not just an issue of structure in the sense that they don't have the capacity to do these things, but that there is in essence almost a reluctance, if you will, to take these sorts of bold decisions that the BBI judgment exhibited.
I think I'm going to quibble with one little part of Zane's presentation, which is that, you know, the judiciary is carrying the load. I think the judiciary is carrying the load, but also citizens. I think we're having this discussion with Waikwa, and I was saying, actually, the people that the executive should really be afraid of are citizens, because who's bringing petitions to the court? It's citizens.
Right.
Right? You know, it's Kenyans saying, wait a second, no, that's not okay. I think that there is an imagination problem. I'm going to use Kiguru Masharia, Dr. Kiguru Masharia's framing here, that there are some of us who saw the Constitution and saw our aspirations and saw possibility. Right. And there are other people who saw a very limited landscape and saw an opportunity to claw back. And so what, when we constantly talk about the clawing back language, it's because their imagination is limited to what they have seen and what they've experienced. And so they're always trying to revert back to that. Right, and so I see this as a tug of war between us as citizens, those of us who are imagining something better and see the Constitution as a pathway to that, that better life, social, economic, political. It's not just aspirational. We're looking for tangible things as well. And then the people who are holding on. And I think that, you know, you see that friction both at an individual level and at an institutional level.
Right.
And so you when the former CJ Maraga was having difficulty with our petition, it's because he was like, who are these random chicks, for lack of a better word, who have the audacity to come here and use a provision of the Constitution to try and dissolve parliament? Mm-hmm. And it required, you know, sort of bigger actors, LSK and others, to come and reiterate what we had said in 2017 for the Chief Justice to take it seriously. But I also know that I spoke with lots of scholars, you know, and legal practitioners, and they just laugh at me and poo-poo me and say, never, it could never be dissolved. Again, there's a lack of imagination. There's an inability to see that for some of us, this is an opportunity. We see this Constitution and we say, I think I could live a better life if these things were there. I always tell people, I don't fight these fights for fun. I actually want to be a beneficiary of the changed environment. And I have been. I'm very fortunate in that regard. So I think that there is an imagination problem. And I think it goes to what Atsango was talking about, which is, who do you put in place? It is not enough for us to have great laws. It's not enough for us to have, you know, beautiful judgments. Because with the wrong people in place, these judgments are meaningless. But finally, I want to talk about something. The judiciary is going to continue to have an expanded, amplified role as long as the legislature is failing. And so it's important for us to also shift our attention, right? Because it's legislative failures that are bringing us here. Because the judiciary doesn't really initiate cases, right? What's happening is citizens are saying, wait a second, you guys were supposed to check that during that process, and you're not. And so we're seeing large-scale failures at the representation level, at the executive level, and we're bringing all this to the judiciary. And it is unsustainable. So I think we really do need to have an honest, hard conversation with ourselves as citizens about how else do we shift attention to the legislature, to the executive? What are some of the things that we need to do to make sure that we're not really, really just drowning one arm of government? Because it's also, it becomes a strategy then for the non-functioning arms to essentially sink the functioning arm, right? So you force them to make difficult decisions that then cannot be that cannot be implemented or will not be implemented. And so we're in this state of unconstitutionality. I mean, we're already there, but
just to piggyback on what Marilyn has just said, if you look at the situation in the US, I mean, you've got this big sort of constant fights over who are going to be the judges in the Supreme Court. And in essence, it seems to me like they are relegated, or they are putting on the judges there to be the arbiters of really political questions, you know. And I'm wondering whether with this sort of expanded role that the judiciary is taking here, are we replicating that? Are we going to get into a situation where who becomes the a judge of the Supreme Court then becomes a big issue, even in this case, a judge of the High Court becomes a big contestation between the two groups that have been mentioned of the people who see opportunity within the Constitution and people who see it as basically a threat? Are we in danger of getting there?
I'm not sure that we are in the danger of getting there, but let me just preface this by saying that unlike even the US, we have a very powerful judiciary based on what the Constitution provides. And one thing I think that was not appreciated just when 2010 Constitution was coming into effect is how powerful the judiciary or the Constitution made the judiciary to be. So a lot of people are not paying attention to the judiciary, partly because everybody, especially the power bearers, whether formal or informal power bearers, still believed that it was possible to continue with the past. And so it didn't really matter too much who becomes judge. And we saw that even in terms of Kibaki's first act, he thought he could just ignore the Constitution and appoint his buddies to be the Attorney General, Chief Justice, and I think Director of Public Prosecution. And based on what Marilyn was talking about, citizens were in court very quickly and thwarted his plan. So that's one. When you look at the US, for example, the Congress has significant power. Judiciary is restrained a lot on deciding some of the policy and what they consider to be political issues. So for example, in the US, they have what they call political question doctrine, whether an issue itself is political in nature, and so the judiciary should not touch it. And we know, for example, the current Supreme Court does subscribe quite a lot to that, just because of who is in that court and how they were appointed. Of course, this is where Paul Mwangi, the lead lawyer of BBI, wants to take us. A lot of us have seen him talk about judicialization of politics, saying that what the judiciary is doing is to take over politics and now be the one dictating how our politics should be done. But that's not obviously the case. The judiciary is given the power and the obligation to actually check compliance on exercise of public power, regardless of the subject matter. So in that way then, as long as first, and this for me is important and tying to what colleagues have said before, one, judges themselves need to appreciate their role in the Constitution. They need to appreciate, and now I have to credit both Asango and Zane here. There's a provision the constitutional makers, and we have two of them, and I know Bobby also is with us, Bobby Mkangi. 159, I think 3 or 4E, where they say the judiciary is the one to protect the purpose and the principles of the Constitution. They didn't give purpose to anybody else, only right. The judiciary. When you think about what the purpose of the Constitution is social transformation. Mm-hmm. Judges have an active obligation to reimagine the society and to render their judgment so that their judgments can actually be used as tools to transform the society. And in a way, when you think about BBI judgment, that is what the judges, to some extent, were trying to do. The judges saw this is a coup. The Constitution places the people at the top, and all of a sudden, the political class has found a way to completely overturn that and now bring the politicians to be the one controlling the agenda. And the judges said, you can't do that because there is a history. So right. When judges fully appreciate that, they don't get mesmerized by jurisdiction like the US, which in a lot of ways are not comparable jurisdictions for us. They also fully appreciate the society they live in and the problems and how they need to interact with. And when we talk about the use of language in BBI, That's also a very intellectual, but also humbling way of judges understanding their people and how they need to communicate with them. Mm-hmm. Then I think we would be in a good place. Of course, there is always going to be contestation. And now right. there is a full appreciation, I think, within the political class, how important who becomes a judge is. And so we will be seeing more of that contestation.
Yeah, well, I can imagine that's where we are going to be headed. But just coming to the meat of what was in the judgment, Zane, maybe you can start us off on this. There's been a lot of talk of the idea of basic structure. And for me, first is to understand what is that basic structure? You know, it seems to me there wasn't a prescription that said that it is clauses 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, you know, and that's it, you know. So what exactly is that basic structure that is being protected, you know? And also a corollary to that is what happens when it's there, but it is not being implemented? Where are we left as citizens?
Let me start where Marilyn stopped and say that one of the things that should be appreciated is that of the three arms of three branches of government, we chose not to devolve the judiciary. Mm-hmm. Okay? So we did not devolve the judiciary, not because we did not see models. The American Constitution, where we borrowed a lot of ideas from, has a devolved judiciary.
Right.
We went the route where my brother Waiko was saying, that the judiciary became above the fray of politics. We wanted mm-hmm. the judiciary to be above these other arms of government, and also to serve the country equally and to be above the fray of the politics in the country, one of the reasons. But also importantly, when you have an executive that is devolved, so you have an executive at the national government and an executive at county, I haven't seen governors, executives protecting the judiciary. It's only when their rights are infringed, they go to the judiciary.
Right.
So I wanted to make that comment, but I'll come back to it because there's two other points that I wanted to make. But in terms of the basic structure, you go back to a number of things. One is the philosophy of this constitution. Mm-hmm. Two are the values of this constitution. Three is the design of this constitution. So that when you look at them holistically, the philosophy, the values, and the design is what gives you an idea of what the basic structure is. Secondly, because people have talked at least at a very technical level, I'm going to give Kenyans an example that can resonate with anyone. Say, for example, you are building a house, right? And you hire the right people to build the house for you. So you work with them, you agree what kind of aesthetics that house should have, what kind of conveniences that house should have, what kind of structure that house should have, mm-hmm. and you end up with a bungalow, right?
Right.
And you want a bungalow with a garden and other amenities. And you will then develop a foundation fitted for a bungalow.
Mm-hmm.
And then if somebody comes and say, now let us put a block of flats on top of this bungalow, right? Then the professional will tell you that the architecture of this house, the bungalow,
right.
cannot take a block of flats on top of it.
Right.
You may add a pool, a swimming pool. That mm. aesthetically, you may want to do that. You mm. may even add a room for a growing sun at the back without right. changing the aesthetics of the bungalow.
Right.
But if somebody came and said, now we own this bungalow together, now we want to put a 10-story building on top of it, said, no, hold on. This house cannot take another 10 structures on top.
Right.
Right. So that's the equivalent. And I think that's the similitude of what the basic structure philosophy is about. And we need to talk in this language so that people understand what this really means. So, for example, one of the fundamental principles in our constitution, which is part of that basic structure, is that it is the people who are sovereign.
Right.
You know, there was a question in this country, sometimes the executive will claim that they are sovereign. And there was even a misnomer in our culture where people said the president is above the constitution. The president is above the law. How can he be above the law or she when that law is the one which is creating this person? So we settled that once and for all and said the people are sovereign.
Right.
Another one is the supremacy of the constitution.
Mm-hmm.
So if you talk about in this constitution, we said nothing can be done outside this constitution. It has to be done under this constitution in accordance with this constitution. So when you have people who want to do this outside, they are always brought back. And I'll give you three examples. You know, people think the executive or the legislature were the first one to test this concept of the supremacy of the constitution. No, it was not. It was the judiciary. The first people who wanted to test this constitution was the serving judicial officers who said, we don't want to be vetted.
Right.
We don't want to be vetted. And you remember the way they even went to court to their brother and sister judges and said, we don't want to be vetted. We resolved that very easily and said, no, you'll have to be vetted.
Right.
The first deputy chief justice of this country refused to retire. Mm-hmm. And he said, no, I was appointed in the former constitution. So again, it was tested. And then I'll give you an example of parliament.
Mm-hmm.
Both the National Assembly and the Senate, they passed a law claiming that they are not state officers. Because when they wanted to allocate themselves perks, they were told, no, now as state officers, you fall under the purview of the Salaries and Remuneration Commission.
Right.
So you cannot change that. And then they passed a law and claimed that they are not state officer because of that law.
Yeah.
Again, it was tested. So I'm giving you examples of saying, We can talk about the broad nature of what this architecture is. But let me make two last points on the basic structure. One, we are not saying you cannot alter the basic structure. That's not what this judgment is saying. And it is wrong for people to claim that it is saying that. It is saying if you want to change the basic structure, you must follow the same process or even a higher standard to address the issue of changing the structure, right? And I'll give you an example that in both the law that supervise the constitution making process of CKRC and the committee of experts, the intentions and the matters that were going to be addressed were put in the law, right? So that they became justiciable, meaning you could go to court and enforce them if they were not addressed.
Right.
So, In a nutshell, and this is the last point I wanted to make, in a nutshell, you, in terms of what Marilyn was saying about imagination, the part of the challenge of imagination is that some people cannot construe a different system from the oppressive system that was rejected totally by this constitution.
Right.
And when we say part of this imagination is that we are saying fundamentally this constitution, the approach that it took, both in terms of its law that established the review process and the process itself and the outcome, was that it was rejecting a a past that was unjust, mm-hmm. and it was envisaging a future that is just. Now, right. this envisaging is part of the challenge many people are having. So this basic structure is also related to that rejection mm-hmm. of an oppressive past.
Right. So that I get the rejection of the oppressive past, and maybe Atsango and Marilyn, you guys can jump in on this. If it's rejecting a past and it is prescribing a future, what happens when that future is ignored? So for example, if we say the Constitution is supreme, and that is something that cannot be, is part of its basic structure, how do we end up with a judge who declares they call chief administrative secretaries illegal, but they stay in office? You know, how do we end up with a parliament that is clearly not in accordance with the Constitution in terms of its makeup, but it is still allowed to continue? Isn't this itself something that says, yes, we might say in paper, we've got a basic structure of a constitution, but we don't have a constitutional government, to be quite honest. Maybe Atsango, you can start, and then I'll come to Marilyn.
Okay, so the challenge that we are confronted with now is the challenge of implementation and the challenge of the fact that historically, we did not have a culture of constitutionalism. We have a culture where people did not respect the constitution and so did what they wanted to do. That's part of our past. And so we are now confronted with the challenge of implementation. And this is a challenge that is not going to end today. So it's important that, first of all, we get the principle. How do you get that principle? Is when you go to court and the court interprets, because that is the role of the court. The court interprets the constitution and says that this is or is not unconstitutional. Whether or not we are able to actually enforce those decisions is now a different battle. And right. in different jurisdictions, this has been handled differently. For example, in India, and I don't remember the name of the case, but we've had instances where they had the government disobeying the courts, and the courts would say that they would not hear the government when it would bring the government of the day, when it would bring a case to the court, because that same government will have to come back before the court. And so they would then say to them, until you purge yourself of this contempt, we will not hear you. And so there's different ways in which judiciaries deal with this issue. But the other aspect to this is actually the responsibility of the citizen. And these are some of the things I've been talking about. Because in terms of protecting the constitution, the judiciary is not the only arm of the state that has been given the responsibility. All these state officers, and make no mistake about it, every single elected person, anybody that holds an elective office under the 2010 constitution is a state officer. They are defined as a state officer. So whether they are an MCA, whether they are a member of the Senate, whether they're a member of the National Assembly, or they are a member of the cabinet, or they are, and the cabinet is not elected, but you know, they are appointed through the, by the executive, or if they are the head of state, you know, the president or the deputy president, these are all state officers. They swear as part of their oath of office to protect the constitution. Now, we as Kenyans have to re-examine, it's something I've kept saying and I'm not going to stop saying it. We as Kenyans have to examine who it is that we elect, because we choose to put these people in office. When we choose to offer the opportunity to hold office, public office, when we choose to offer the privilege of holding electoral office to people who have consistently violated the constitution, or who have a history of engaging in acts that are illegalities, we are making a choice to actually undermine the constitution. And so to me, the undermining there of the constitution is not just by the political elite who we you know, who we put in office, but it is also by us as a public.
The choices that we make.
Yeah, we are absconding our responsibility under Article 3 to protect the Constitution. When we go to a ballot box and we knowingly choose somebody who we know has demonstrated time and time again that they won't respect the Constitution. And so there is a value in having the decision.
Mm-hmm.
Whether or not we will be able to enforce that decision today is a different matter. But at least the decision is there. And we can, at some point in the future, rely on that decision.
Right. I just wanted to mention here, because we've got people listening in and audience, you can put in any questions that you have for the panelists on the chat function. And we'll put them up. I'll pick them up from there, and I can I'll put them to the panelists. Marilyn, we've had this thing where I think the Supreme Court has said this before, and we've had others speak of progressive implementation of the Constitution. So it says this, but well, in times to come, we will do it. How does that sit with this idea of basic structure? Seems to me it kind of throws that out.
So I think, again, one of the things that happened was the political elite created narratives. And those narratives influenced judicial offices as well. I think that this is partly where, you know, the progressive realization came. We have the fifth schedule of the Constitution, where we needed to have certain legislation in place by 2015, 16, if there was an extension by a year. And so it wasn't completely out of the blue to talk about progressive, but there was a framework. There was still a time-bound sense of certainty that by 2016 latest, we would be existing in this new state, right? I think for me, the challenge, and I think you posed a bigger question when to Atsango, which is sort of what happens when we sort of are going back to constitutions without constitutionalism, right?
Right.
Like, we're kind of going back there with a judiciary that's helping us with decisions, but again, with two arms of government, the legislature and the executive, that are staunchly anti-constitution and anti-constitutionalism. The risks, I think, are that we are not ourselves taking time seriously. And that sounds like an odd thing to say, but and we've had this conversation with some people who we've been doing this public interest litigation with, which is that the state understands the value of time in eroding norms. They understand that very, very clearly. And so when a decision is suspended, when you get a suspended judgment and the CAS is still sitting in office, or the CSs who've been unconstitutional twice now are still sitting in office, what the state learns is it's okay, we can manage. When we go to court and we get orders that require parliament enact legislation within 60 days and they don't and nothing happens, it emboldens actors. And so part of the risk is that we ourselves as citizens are not taking time seriously, that we are not understanding that what is happening with the passage of time is the erosion of our norm. So I really liked the foundation example that Abubakar gave us. Mine's not going to be as good, but let's think of the Constitution as like a rock in a river. And time is the water, right? Mm-hmm. Over time, you know, water is going to erode the rock. And that's really what's happening. And, you know, I say this because a lot of women, especially, really called a crisis in like 14 and leading up to 15 before we got to the timeline for the fifth schedule. And we were really dismissed. And it was really, that was the time when we really needed to all have alarm bells ringing. And the next best time is now, right? The next best time for us to be saying, actually, perhaps we should really consider whether any of these state officers should even be eligible for public office in 2022. Yeah. I mean, if you cannot uphold these provisions, why are we risking this again? You know, what are we doing to ourselves? I think the bigger question you're really asking is, how do we as citizens get out of having a constitution that is then eroded by, you know, a lack of constitutionalism? How do citizens engage in upholding constitutions? And part of it is withdrawing support. I think we think too much about voting, but there is also the very, very basic things you can do. I've been telling people since like 2015, every time you submit memoranda to the National Assembly or Senate, your first point should be, and oh, by the way, you guys are unconstitutional. Oh, by the way, because part of what you're doing when you create this record is you're starting to say, when it matters, when we want to come back. And I always say the people who will fight this fight, for whom it will matter, will probably, by the way, be corporations. You'll find some corporation at some point is going to decide, you know what? That tax rate, that law that was passed, wait a second, Parliament is unconstitutional. They didn't meet the two-thirds gender rule. They don't care about the two-thirds gender rule.
Right.
It's going to be in their interest at that point. So part of how we do it is this systematic erosion as well. The same way they use time, we have to use time. We can't have sporadic episodic engagement, which is kind of what we've been doing as citizens.
Right. And I think I just want to push a little bit on this thing of progressive implementation, because I think if you've got a constitution, it says you've got to do this by this time. And then that time comes and it's pushed back, you know, and eventually it's not implemented. You know, it seems to me it negates the whole point of having that, of having that provision, of having that thing. So shouldn't we be in the position of saying, if there is indeed a basic idea underlying or a basic structure underlying the constitution and it is not complied with, that it's time to talk about consequences rather than thinking about giving people more time to implement it?
Yeah, so there are a number of things in terms of how to deal with that. There has been discussion about the role of citizens in terms of being vigilant and in terms of demanding that the constitution be complied with. And I think way back, Marilyn started us on the issue of lack of imagination. And then Asango has talked about how citizens themselves have facilitating the frustration of the constitution. For me, how the politicians seem to be winning, because for me, they are not necessarily winning. And the reason why they are not necessarily winning, even though it may look like they're winning in the short term, is court orders are not perishable. And so as long as you have vigilant citizen, 10 years from now, things people are doing today, they could have be held accountable for. Rachel Shabesh, who is being paid illegal salary as a CAS with a Babuna Mwamba, there might be a time when we will go and ask that they return that money, because there's already a judgment that says that those are illegal position. And remember, under the constitution, accountability is individual, it's not corporate. And so people need to know that. However, I still, but the second point about citizens is, and politicians, this contestation, is citizens also now have to take charge. What the politicians have done, and especially Uhuru has been very, very good at this, is to create narratives that instill psychological trauma on citizens. If you look at what they called reggae with Raila Odinga, reggae was actually an instrument of psychological trauma. I was surprised yesterday attending the elections conference that even fairly informed people still are talking about a referendum, possibility of a referendum happening before the 2022 general elections. And what people don't seem to appreciate is that they were subjected to so much to so much trauma, they are still recovering from the notion of the indispensability of a referendum. These are traumatized people, and the citizens need to give themselves or to do self-help and now reclaim the narrative and say, no, no, this is what's going to happen, and these are our priority. But coming to implementation of the judgment, of course, one of the things I get really frustrated about when we litigate these cases is the fact that a lot of these judgments are good. A lot of them end up diagnosing the problem and providing the best way to resolve it. But when it comes to the actual remedy, that's where they suspend. And it's hard sometimes for me not to think that at some point, judges feel this is too much. This is too dramatic. Yeah. And so the question becomes, what do we need to do to give the judges the next level of energy they need to be able to actually say, no, enough is enough, and it's now. It's not tomorrow. We're not suspending the judgment. And partly why BBI judgment is so fundamental is because it didn't seek to suspend anything. Even the illegality of IBC, that was suspended not in the judgment, but just based on an application that was made in court after the judgment. So you can see, and yet after that judgment, you can see how much people have seen the possibilities that we can have with the Constitution. Can you imagine if the same thing was said about CAS? Can you imagine if the court, because it's not the court's problem at some level, to say, they only say this is what the law says and this is where we end. The court said, you have to fix parliament because that's what the Constitution requires. So I think we need to move to the next level. But let's also not forget, in public service, nobody is doing more work than people in the judiciary. A lot of us don't appreciate how much work judges and magistrates carry. And we also have to be realistic in terms of the demands we put in on them. Of course, the Constitution has already put those demands. So the best we can do is to lighten the load for them by actually protecting their space and protecting what they're doing and defending them when they come under attack and demanding, for example, now that Uhuru should be appointing the six judges. In fact, citizens need to remember, because Parliament has refused to impeach Uhuru, which is the remedy that the citizens have to an unperforming serial violator of a constitution in a president. Citizens need to invoke Article 118 and draft their own articles of impeachment. Let Parliament refuse to act on citizens.
Citizens can act.
Let's defend the judiciary.
You've addressed one of the questions that we got from on the chat, which was about the ruling on IEDC as not having a quorum as being essentially illegal. But I think the corollary to that, and maybe Abubakar, you can start us off on this, is if I think it's a question about the effect of the judgment. So now they have said this, it's been said at the high level, at the court, at the high court level, you know, it's being appealed, and because of that, some of its effects, I think, have been suspended. What happens when, if it is upheld, you know, does now that mean that, for example, all the elections that the IEBC has been overseeing suddenly become illegal, you know, and does that mean then we have to go back to all these by-elections and start again, you know? My second thing is, would it then be, would it apply to all other courts, basically all the other high courts, if somebody went in with another mention? The reason I ask this is we've got a high court judgment that says police cannot take you to court and then say you're held as they go look for they look for evidence, basically, as they complete investigations. The High Court said that was illegal, but other courts have been allowing police to do this, you know, keep doing it. So my question again is, what's the actual effect of this judgment going forward? Will it become something that is precedent setting that everybody else has to apply to? And looking back again at the IBC issue, does that mean we have to redo all the elections that the IBC has overseen?
If you are a state officer and you have sworn to uphold the Constitution, and the court has made a ruling that touches on you, it is incumbent upon you to resign. Mm-hmm. You know, some of these things are very personal. How do you justify staying in an office that has been declared unconstitutional? Let's forget about what the others are saying. Let's talk about personal responsibility that is accruing to every public official, to every state officer. If it has been said the office you hold is unconstitutional, your integrity should demand of you to say, I resign. I cannot continue drawing a salary and allowances and pretend I'm working, yet what I am doing is illegal. It's unconstitutional. By the way, Gadara, I'm a sociologist. I'm not a lawyer, right. I'm a sociologist. So let me speak again from that perspective, meaning what? We need to go a step further. In many jurisdictions, we have realized that until somebody is held accountable at a personal level, mm-hmm. People will hide behind institutional frameworks.
Right.
So what do we do? We must go back to court and say, because somebody who was mentioned in a court order to do a specific thing and they refuse to obey the court order, then we should ask for that person, he or she, to be held in contempt.
Right.
Of a court order. Mm-hmm. And we should ask relief from the court. I know I talked about pressure. Mm-hmm. Okay. But let's go to the next issue I wanted to talk about, which is this idea of the not more than two-thirds of the same gender.
Right.
Judgment by the Supreme Court. First of all, we must say that was a majority decision. Mm-hmm. And to some of us, the minority decision was the one which made sense. But the architecture of our judiciary is such that the Supreme Court has the power to revisit its own decision. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So that's another avenue that we can go to. And particularly bearing in mind all the matters that required progressive approach, we mentioned them by name in the Constitution. Mm-hmm. Yeah? Those matters that require progressively, we mentioned them by name. So they departed from that philosophy and they decided to add to the list of what they consider.
Right. And now hopefully they can go back and relook at this. I really want to get to the questions that are being asked here. So Sarah Kimani of SABC News asks about the claims that this is judicial activism and that civil society are sponsoring these rulings. Perhaps, Chesoni, you can quickly just address that and we'll move on from it.
One of the biggest mysteries for me post the 2010 Constitution is this whole notion of judicial activism. I actually don't know what that phrase means. I hear it tossed around quite a bit. So I may be the person that is most incompetent to answer this. My own interpretation of the phrase is that there's a bunch of people that think that, you know, when they call people activists, it's a dirty word and that they're insulting them. And so their way of demeaning judges who rule in a way in which they don't agree with is to call them activists.
Right.
I don't know that my own interpretation, because I do think there's actually a theory, and there I will defer to Waikwa, who I think is a bit more competent holding a PhD.
Waiko, what do you
think? In some of these matters, I will leave it there. I will then say on whether or not civil society is sponsoring it. Again, it is part of the same culture of propaganda.
Demonizing civil society.
Yeah, some of us who are members of civil society who then went on to ask questions about certain types of injustices at one point in time were labeled evil. And so, you know, it's part of the propaganda and part of the way in which the political elite is attempting to cast aspersion on the bench in order, you know, simply because they don't agree with the decision.
All right. Waiko, what do you think about judicial activism?
It's actually constitutional activism. It's not judicial activism.
Right.
In fact, what we probably have in Kenya is a little bit conservative at the judiciary level, because when we actually even talking about, for example, judgments and the fact that judges at some point feel like they can go beyond a certain point, that is conservatism. When we talked, Asango just talking about the two-third gender advisory, the majority of judges at the Supreme Court actually chose to be conservative because the Constitution was relatively clear about timelines and obligations. And in fact, we wouldn't be in the situation we're in now if the judges had not been conservative. So the Constitution is actually more activist than our judges. It's the judges who need to catch up. that's our dilemma at the moment.
Right. Marilyn, there's a question about judges postponing implementation of their decisions and whether that amounts to undermining the supremacy of the Constitution. I think this was actually, he is referring to the issue of the CASs. But I think also to what I had asked previously about the effect of this particular judgment,
mm-hmm.
you know. So if it is upheld, and we've had an IEBC that's been running by-elections, are all those by-elections then automatically voided?
Simple answer would be yes. And I think one of the things we need to do though is reframe that question. And because this is, it is framed in that way so that judges can balk and say, oh my God, that's just too big. And I think the reframing of that would be, when is it in the public interest to maintain unconstitutionality? You know, we have a framing problem because what the state is basically asking us to do is, you know, we go out and we violate all these laws and we know they're violations. And then we come here and we say, but you know, it's going to be so much work to undo this, you know? And so part of what we're developing, I think, is a jurisprudence that is defining public interest to include unconstitutionality. Because how else do you say that you can maintain clearly unconstitutional action in the public interest, right? Or in deference to one branch of government. So I do think that the answer would be yes, but I don't think that that's a bad answer. I think what that does is, I used to say that I thought the idea was to get us to such a big constitutional crisis that we abandoned the Constitution of Kenya altogether. And to be honest, I'm not so sure that we're still that far off, because part of what this intractability is, the IEBC is unconstitutional, Parliament is unconstitutional, the executive at cabinet level is unconstitutional, Supreme Court just became constitutional you know, a month ago. Part of what that was a check on each other. All these unconstitutional bodies were protecting each other. So in part, the Supreme Court's constitutionality is a threat to the continued existence of these other unconstitutional bodies. And we do need to be careful about that, that we do not then revert back to, okay, how do we get everybody back in the same boat, you know, so that we're all unconstitutional together. We are in a crisis. It does mean that the remedial measures that need to be taken are significant. But postponing it is not going to make it better. It's like saying, I'm not going to go for my, you know, I have a tumor in my breast. I feel it. I really should go for a biopsy, but I'm not going to go because it might be bad. As if I go 3 years later, it's going to be a better result. You know, I really think that's where we are.
Okay. I think there's a question here for Zane that directly for you. It says, what is the role of national culture and constitutionalism in breaking the culture of impunity, corruption, and other misfortunes ailing Kenya? I think you've discussed a little bit about it, but maybe you could give us a quick short answer.
Simple, three things. One, in the constitution making process, we accepted that culture is an important imperative in the constitutional framework. But unfortunately, the cultural, many of the cultural provisions were edited out and taken out as part of the political deal in Naivasha. We had a whole chapter on culture. We had an institutional framework for implementing culture, but that was taken out. But the second aspect is that when Professor Ogendo talked about having constitution without constitutionalism, part of it was that because we have not internalized the values and the philosophy of that constitution, and we have made it part of us, and we want to leave it, to leave them. And when I was making reference to personal responsibility to some of these state institutions, we also have to ask those who your composition has been said does not have constitutional mandate because of quorum issues, but you are still meeting and making decisions.
Right.
So again, how do you? Until we are able to extend this personal responsibility to people who do that, then it is very difficult. But two final things: we must continue with civic education. We must seek to inculcate constitutional history and development as part of our education system, and touch people young. If we are not able to do that, you will still have people, it's called a culture of impunity. Mm-hmm. But also let me add one last word on the question of activism. If you agree that the 2010 constitution is a transformative constitution, then it means that it is demanding of people to embrace change and transformation. So when you do embrace it, it doesn't mean that you are being activist. You are actually obeying the constitution.
Right. we have a question here from Dennis Esikuri. And he asks, should we have many civil society members join political spaces, win elective seats, and fight from within parliament for legislation and passing progressive bills? You see, I think he's asking whether we should be taking the fight to defend the constitution into parliament by ourselves, choosing to participate in electoral politics. I mean, I would preface that question by just noting that the record of people we've sent to parliament has not really been encouraging. So I don't know, maybe Zane, you could start with that, and then we could ask Chisodi as well.
Again, let's go back to our constitution, okay?
Right.
The constitution says that the people of Kenya exercises their sovereignty directly or through their democratically elected representatives. Let's start with directly. We didn't tell people this, but we have constitutionalized mass action. And we know that that's our history. That's how we got this constitution. So the right to assemble, the right to protest, the right to picket. You know, people think protesting and picketing is the same. Picketing is much more picketing is much more robust. You could go right. and say, we are going to make a particular office occupy it.
Right.
You know, occupy, this occupation mentality is part of our constitution now.
Right.
But also, as somebody said, elections, participating in elections directly is also our responsibility. Mm-hmm. But it doesn't mean that we cannot run for election. I can tell you, we have very many examples of a few good men and women who were able to operate in a much more difficult time in parliament and fight for democratization within parliament. I don't know how many people remember the story of the bearded sisters in courts,
right. uh-huh.
and a few people who stood up. So you don't need a lot of people. You only need a critical mass of people going into these spaces. Until and unless, because politics in Kenya has been made to look very bad, good people are shying away from seeking to serve. The same way people are demonizing judiciary, it will reach a time you may end up having good people not wanting to go to the judiciary because the way they are treated. So I'm saying, please, let's not give up. Let's mm-hmm. go into the spaces and let's go and work. And the last thing, don't see going to public service as an end in itself that after that, I don't want to work anymore. No, go and make your contribution and implement this constitution properly. And when you leave, continue working. This right. idea of seeing a public office as a place to make money is the wrong place.
Just in terms of this shift of people saying, let's get better people into parliament, because as the discussion has noted, it's one of the spaces where the defense of the constitution is not happening. Would that be an effective way of changing things, or do we need to do more than simply electing better people?
The question for me, the starting point is, who are good and bad people? So judges have done very well. We've talked about it within the same country. Is it that judges are drawn from a different crop of people or a different country? No. But why is it that the judiciary relative to other institutions have done very well, even relative to independent commissions? It's, for me, the solution is not the people. The solution is the institution. How do you build institutions? How do you create transformative institutions? How do you create a culture of transformation? How do you make people, when they come to an institution, know that, as has been stated, you're not becoming an MP. That is not the end, it's a means. And what is that purpose? What's your purpose? And that is what the judiciary seemed to do fairly well. And I think we fail to credit the leadership of the judiciary in this sense, in terms of, for example, when you go to the Willie Mutunga's tenure, the fact he came up with the transformation, I think they call it judiciary transformation framework. And then Justice Maraga continued with that. And we keep hoping that Justice Koome will also accelerate that, or at least make sure that she continues to instill the constitutional culture within the judiciary. If Muturi, Justin Muturi had a vision and a purpose as the speaker, he would have created rules and a culture that would have made our parliament first and foremost independent, because we forget parliament also is supposed to be independent. Dignified. We don't have a dignified parliament. Can you imagine how painful it is for people like Orengo and Otiende, who, if we were thinking about good people, these are the people we would be thinking of sending to parliament.
Right.
How painful and indignifying it is for them to say, you know what, Senator Omogeni, you know what, this bill is unconstitutional. But when it comes to voting, yes.
Yeah.
at some level, you also have to sympathize with that person. The institution and the political arrangements have debased and indignified them to that level that they don't have any personal or professional pride. That's what our judges have that our MPs don't have. So how do we create those institutions that make those who work there to feel secure and also to feel that they have a stake, not just personal, but institutional and beyond, to protect that institution and perpetuate the good that that institution should be doing. The president, how do we make the president honor the constitution? Of course, some people are irredeemable. So that is a problem.
You spoke before about having judgments that are very good at analyzing the problems and not as good at giving us a remedy. So what is your remedy?
My remedy is that Kenyans have to find ways to insist that we have to build proper institutional institutions. Think why we've lost the Independent Commission. Because we allowed Uhuru to use the independent commissions to reward people who lost political power. That's how people like Priscilla Nyokabi are in the gender commission. And that's why she has to go around parroting BBI and even justifying Uhuru not performing a constitutional obligation of appointing judges. We have more examples. It's not just Priscilla Nyokabi. Let's insist, and whenever there is an attack on an institution, let's actually gang up and protect that institution. And we can start by protecting the judiciary and giving it the space to work.
Asango, let me come to you and ask about this push to say, let's put in people. You've said that it's about who we elect, we shouldn't elect serial abusers of the constitution. But in as much as we try to change people, they always seem to revert to this norm, you know, and Waiko has mentioned a bit about it. So what is left for the citizen who wants to defend this constitution? You know, is it simply go to the streets, or, you know, how else can he participate in ensuring, for example, the legislature upholds the constitution?
I think Abu had spoken earlier about how this is, you know, transformation is not overnight, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
And then also, I disagree slightly. It's a pity Waiko wasn't able to be with us. I disagree that it's just about the institutions. When I was younger, I used to think it was just about the institutions. Successfully having promulgated a new constitution, which created strong institutions. For me, I am very clear today that when you have a nascent democracy, when you have nascent institutions, who holds office also matters. And so some of the kind of things we should be doing, and I don't think that we will get good leadership just from civil society. Having been in civil society, having had to undertake work where I was studying different things about civil society, there are individuals who were in civil society who I can tell you for a fact were corrupt, for example.
Right.
And if some of those people go into public office, they won't behave any differently. So I think we need to, whenever people put themselves forward for public office, we need to look at who they were before. We don't just look at who they are today or the banner that they picked up yesterday or in the past couple of months on the way to preparing themselves. So we need to continue with the work of creating a critical mass of the kind of people that we think should be in office. We need to look at the way in which we should be putting together lists, for example, of if tomorrow offices come up, whereby people should be nominated. Do we have lists of people who we think are the kind of caliber of people that should, you know, that should be put there, or that should apply when people are appointed? Waiko had just mentioned the gender commission. The manner in which the current gender commissioners, with all due respect, were appointed was very clandestine.
Right.
That process itself should have been challenged.
Mm-hmm.
And so if we keep also insisting on transparent processes, on processes that ensure that people come into, first of all, that the opportunity to apply for a position is one that is public, because the Constitution is very clear about that. So that people who actually have the appropriate credentials and competences are given the opportunities. All these things will make a difference. So for me, it's a number of different things. And I think it is opening ourselves to the fact that good people can be found everywhere. It's not just in one particular sub, it's not just in one particular subsector. And what we should be insisting on is that we, for any form of public office, that the people that are under consideration and that have the opportunity to serve are people of integrity, people who have demonstrated themselves to be people of integrity. And that when people abuse public office, they also bear sanctions. There's nothing that prevents us, for example, if somebody, you know, earned a salary that they should not have earned, there's nothing that prevents us from suing them.
Right.
Get the, you know, under the old constitution, there are people who were detained, who went to court before 2010 and sued Moi, whilst Moi was still alive and still a person that was powerful.
Right.
And so with this constitution, we have even more instruments. And it's not just the individuals who are directly affected. There is one additional benefit. With this constitution, we can, under the Bill of Rights, where it's a rights violation, sue on behalf of people who, for some reason, cannot institute measures.
Right.
But we do.
If I may ask Marilyn about the sort of the institution of parliament and accountability for them. You know, I think if one of the things we want to be able to do is to force parliament to essentially do our bidding, then we've got to be able to hold them to account. But one of the main ways that we are supposedly enabled to do that is by being able to recall them, but they've then gone about and rubbished it, how we are to do it, the law they passed to activate that part of the constitution went. I would think that's a fairly fundamental bit of the constitution might be covered by this whole basic structure bit. But how do we go about ensuring that it is actually done? We as citizens, you've been quite involved in pushing for, you know, declarations and stuff in court. How can we take this fight to parliament?
So I think we go back to, you know, where the constitution locates power, and the constitution locates power in the people, right? And I think that that's really sort of where we are again. So part of how we have to do the accountability work, and I agree it is both individual and institutional, I think both matter. But as somebody who's a perennial outsider, I seem to never be an insider. I think I can speak much better to how to work it outside. And I think part of what you do when you're outside the system is you're holding space. And sometimes you're holding space actively with court cases. Other times you're really just holding space, waiting for the next people to come and just take the baton from you because you're just tired as all hell. You know, and it is important that we are, as Abubakar was saying, we are clear that this is a process, that we are passing through this time. And what we should be very, very clear about as well, I think, is we must keep that imagination of where we are going alive. Because if we do not keep that imagination alive, if we keep front and center the violations, the indignity, really the trampling of the constitution, if we keep that too large, too visible, if that picture is vibrant and clear, then we can't see where we're going. And so part of our job and part of the resistance is literally keeping an imagination alive, keeping that vision alive. And it can seem like it's futile. And I think this is one of the ways that I think we really need to be grateful to artists, you know, people who write fiction, poetry, you know, songs. I'm thinking about A Kenyan Message by Muthoni the Drummer Queen. You know, I mean, we've had all these people basically capturing what we feel and sort of holding that space for us. And again, I think this is the culture bit. This is the way we can change it, that they can't control as much.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the judgments, we will continue to do that. There are those of us who can do that. But as individuals, anyone who's on Twitter knows that people are constantly sending Boniface Mwangi DMs. Yeah. Boniface Mwangi has no elected position, yet he seems to have more power than many MPs. Mm-hmm. So there is power that is located outside of political position. And we as citizens are also giving it, because when you're sending Boniface Mwangi a DM, you're saying, I know that you can do things.
Right.
So the power is both agenda setting power, but it's also the power to actualize things. And I think one of the things that the legislature is not taking seriously enough is the longer that you are unresponsive to citizens, the more that that power is going to be distributed to other places.
Right.
You know, because the citizens are going to look for answers. You know, I think that's part of also how we're starting to see, you know, it's again, a bit of that self-help. It can be a bit dangerous, vigilantism, but it is a response to, this is where we've located our representative power. You're not responding appropriately. We will withdraw it. Mm-hmm. So I think that's an important way to think about it. It's not legal, but I think that is the analysis of power. Power is wielded to do things, to actualize things for citizens. And we need to return, I think, to an analysis of power that's more service-focused and citizen-focused.
Right. We're coming to the tail end of this. And I want us to kind of also look forward. We've got an appeal process now going, and it should be done, I think they said, by next week. What do you guys think is likely to come out of that? Is it your expectation that if it is not upheld, this would end up at the Supreme Court? Maybe we start with you, Zane, and then just do a quick round with everybody else.
Yeah. So in terms of scenario building, it's not just me. I think many commentators have said that the way the judgment is constructed and it's reasoned and it's written, it's going to be a very steep curve to completely vacate it, as you the word you used. But there are three possible outcomes. You can have a situation where the Court of Appeal affirms the findings of the High Court. Then you can have a situation where it vacates it. So those are the two extreme ones, affirmation, right, vacation. But in between, you have a possibility of some of the issues being vacated and some being affirmed. Now, when you have that third scenario where there's a mixed bag, you then have to analyze and say, do they have an effect to completely change the outcome and make BBI kosher? I don't think so. Mm-hmm. If, for example, they only focus on small peripheral matters to deal with the conduct of the president and apply a saving grace kind of, right, philosophy on that, still it doesn't make change the outcome. But the fourth dimension to this is that parties that are dissatisfied with the outcome of the Court of Appeal will always have an option to go to the Supreme Court. So again, it's a process. But let me say two things, Gadara, before we go. One, many constitutions do not have chapters on leadership and integrity. Because we in Kenya identified leadership as a challenge and integrity as a challenge in our society. That's why we constructed a whole chapter called Leadership and Integrity. So that right. speaks volumes in terms of what deficit we have. But I also agree with those who have spoken and say that we need to focus on the cultural dimension. And to finish, I say, there are three important processes as far as this constitution is concerned. The first one is deconstruction of the past, that we must continue to deconstruct, and we must continue to find new ways of telling our history, our memory, and what went on in our country up to now. The second one is constructing the future. This is a continuation conversation that we are having. And then the third one is the transition between the construction and construction of the future.
Right.
So I think sometimes we are too hard on ourselves. We only think of the things that are not working. We are not looking at how far we have come. There was a time there was detention without trial in this country.
The time we couldn't have this conversation.
This conversation will lead to incarceration.
Right, exactly. So Atsango, for you, way forward, what do you see happening? And what would you like to see happen?
I think the easiest is for me to answer, what would I like?
Right.
I would love a situation where the Court of Appeal completely upholds this judgment. In my opinion, this judgment was affirming, and I completely agree with Waikwa when he said that this is the most historical judgment we have received, because it was dealing with the Constitution in its totality. But more importantly for me, it was affirming the citizen as sovereign. And right. so regardless of how things go at the Court of Appeal, I think the very fact that Kenyans actually saw that there is a place where they can go if they feel that the political elite are not listening, are refusing completely to respect what we all agreed to be bound by, the fact that Kenyans have seen repeatedly that there is a place they can go
right.
and speak out about this, and that it, that can be upheld, that principle that nobody actually is above the law, because that's what this did, that's what this affirmed indirectly, you know? Kenyans understood that the person who holds the most powerful office in this right. country is not above the law.
Exactly, he has to comply.
Yeah, that just like everybody else, he has to comply, that he's a citizen. Right. That message at the psychological level is a very important, message, and there's no gainsaying.
And actually it goes to what you were saying before about the language, because there's a lot of people who talk who said the judges were being disrespectful to the president. But this sort of refusal to kowtow to him, to sort of accord him this status, even after he has violated the constitution, perhaps is also a message to people about the status in which we hold people who carry elected office.
Yeah, because at the end of the day, in the matter of the constitution, the president is a citizen. Like the rest of us. There is no super citizen in the matter of the Constitution. We all are one, regardless of our age, regardless of our ability or disability, regardless of our gender, regardless of all of that. So for me, that is for me what's most important about the about this decision, that it has forced us into a place whereby this conversation has been had and it has affirmed the centrality and the sovereignty of the citizens. And so let me stop there so that Marilyn has an opportunity.
All right. So Marilyn, we began with you 2 hours ago. You will end up. We'll have the final word. What do you see going forward? What is it I would like to see, and especially about the effect this would have? Across, do you think it would change how people relate to government, how Kenyans see their government, or will it just be another blip and we quickly forget about
it? So I think it's already changed how we relate to government. I think it's already changed what people think is possible. And that's what in my view, historic and precedent-setting decisions do, is they change your real world. And if they've changed the real world of ordinary Kenyans, then even if it is overturned on appeal, that moment isn't overturned. It doesn't change your mindset, right? And I think right. that's what I found really exciting about this judgment. The day after it, I remember speaking to a friend of mine and telling them I needed to go out. I needed to be in a place that was huge. Like I needed to be in the forest. I actually went to the forest.
Right.
And I really felt like this was, oh my God, I couldn't have imagined it, you know? And so you don't take that moment away by overturning a decision. So in right. one way, I'm actually quite uninvested in the appellate process. That's why. But secondly, and Waikwa spoke about this, there is no realistic legal way for us to have a referendum before the 2022 election. That right. is the real impact of this decision. And I think that that's one of the things we need to be saying very consistently and very loudly, because, you know, undoing that narrative means that then we can start preparing for the 2022 election.
Right.
Because part of this appellate process is to keep us invested in a referendum, a possible referendum that legally we cannot have before the next general election. Mm-hmm. So I think for me, those are that's the way I choose to look at this judgment. But I do want us to just, I wanted to say this, I don't know why I didn't say it before, but I would be remiss not to talk about the fact that two of those judges are on the list of the six right. that the president refused to appoint, has unconstitutionally refused to appoint, and actually in violation of court orders. There's no stay, right. Although there's an appellate, there's an appeal to the Court of Appeal. And that one of the ways in which we can be vigilant about defending constitutionalism is to protect the individuals who actually do the work. Right. Because while we may not always be able to have consequences for the violators, to throw people who choose to uphold individual and institutional integrity and the national values, to throw them completely under the bus, would also be to undermine our own long-term aspirations. So I just wanted to make sure I said that for the record.
That's great and very well said. Thanks a lot to all our participants. I think it's been a really fascinating discussion. Thanks Marion Kamuru, Atsango Chesoni, Abubakar Zain, and Waikwa Wanyueke, who had to leave a bit earlier. This, as I said at the beginning, is part of a series that the Elephant is doing with the Heinrich-Böll Foundation. We'll be having another one in 2 weeks from now. And we will communicate the dates, both at the Elephant on our social media pages and on the website. If you're interested, there's quite a lot of content that the Elephant has published around this issue. So you can always jump in and have a look at articles written by Waikwa, interviews with Chisoni and others regarding the whole BBI judgment issue. The next webinar will basically be getting a few young people to talk about what this means for them and what they see as being opened up as opportunities for them. With that, thanks a lot, everybody, for being part of this, and we shall see you next time. Bye-bye.